आफ्टरनून।
ऑडिबल।
गुड आफ्टरनून।
गुड आफ्टरनून।
या थैंक यू। सो डेटा साइंस काइंड ऑफ लाइक अमेजिंगली साउंडिंग टर्म, राइट? आई वुड से दिस इज द मोस्ट मिसअंडरस्टूड टर्म इन रीसेंट टाइम्स। लाइक पीपल डू मिसअंडरस्टूड और मिसइंटरप्रीट इट एज अ डेटा एनालिटिक्स। It's not wrong though, but data analytics is kind of subpart of it. Let me give you a few examples. The first thing you are going to get out of my session is the correct definition and scope of data science. And what should be the practical approach? What should be the practical scope for me? Like if I want to get a job, if I want to utilize that skill in my organization or my day on day like tasks, how can I integrate it with my skill set, or do I need to learn something new? So it's all about data. The world is data agnostic. No organization right now is like, let's leave this data part, let's focus on core business. Instead, every organization is trying to invest more and more in data. Why? It helps in every domain, right? You guys have just witnessed something which world was trying to transform since a decade. Digital transform. COVID has actually forced us to like integrate many digital transformations. Many organizations have completely changed their working model into remote capabilities, right? So everything is remote now. Many organizations, just look at the education sector. Colleges, union, they are forced. This is not by choice, obviously. But yes, the capability of doing the same was because we had tools, we had data, and people have innovatively integrated these things. And today, I don't say that it is perfect, but we are witnessing a great digital transformation. Undoubtedly, one big factor I would like to draw here is data. So data is the new oil, according to many tech giants. And it's true. Why? Just look at the business of Google. Just look at the business of Facebook. Just look at the business of LinkedIn. Google is $1 trillion company without selling, direct selling any product to customers like us. Most of the services which you use, I use, are free from Google. How can one organization go to the level of earning $1 trillion and still don't have well-defined products which they sell constantly? Because they don't sell you any specific product. Their main product is analytics, information, not even data. So every organization is keen on capturing more and more and more data so that they can generate info. But wait, what's the difference between data and information actually? Anybody?
Information is a one part of data, or the data which can be used for our benefit. Okay. Maybe for business benefit or personal benefit.
Absolutely. Data is something which is raw collection of statistics, raw collection of facts and figures can be termed as data. While information is something which is useful. Useful data can be termed as information, or processed data can be called as information. Whole IT industry is working on one principle only. They take data as input. They apply some algorithms, or what we call it as logic, and they produce information as output. So every organization is doing only this. So whole IT industry can be formulated into single diagram. Every algorithm can be formulated in single set of rules. This could be a standard SOP for IT industry, I would say. Yeah, data might be different. Information might be like information they require might be less or more depending on the type of business. But ideally, everyone is doing the same. But suddenly,
what happened in last decade, the overall use of internet has, I would say, taken the stage where we can call it as blast. I would not say rapid increase. It would be a small word, rapid increase in data. It's not rapid increase. It's a blast. Because just let me tell you a few amazing stats given by IDC about Google, Facebook, and most of our social media things. Like, you guys post around 1.94 petabyte of data per month on Facebook. By the way, these are 2017 IDC statistics, which is like very old, right? So there are 6 new users on Facebook per second. There are 60 billion messages sent and received per day on WhatsApp. And by the way, WhatsApp is a service where you don't even see any ad, because many people give the frontline answer to Google and Facebook that their main business is advertisement. Okay, agree, point taken. What about WhatsApp? They don't even have advertisements. Still, they are managing to accommodate 60 to 70 billion messages per day. Just imagine about the cloud bill, server bill about of WhatsApp. So here, the basic bare minimum cost of having a decent server and decent hardware with network, whether it's cloud or non-cloud service provider, would be around 10,000 rupees at least, basic, I would say. And I had my e-commerce solution hosted on AWS. It took me from 25,000 per year to around 2 lakh rupees per year when my customer base increased within 2 months. Within 2 months, the forecast changed, because from getting 10 requests per hour to 100 requests per second, the journey was amazing. So where exactly they are earning? They are not selling anything. They are analyzing your data, reanalyzing your data. But wait. What's the point of having more data and reanalyzing data? Let me ask you one question. Approximately, we are around 60 people here in our seminar. So if I ask you one question, which one is your favorite color out of red, green, and blue? Let's say you guys, we take a poll and you guys started voting, and 20 guys vote for red, same amount of people vote for green, and same amount of participants liked blue. So approximately 33, I draw a pie chart, and the pie chart shows that 33.33 loves red, same green, same blue. Now the question is whether my analysis is wrong. Is it wrong? No, absolutely no. Because I have actually asked people, but, well, the second question holds more importance. Is it correct? Absolutely no. Then what's wrong? I need more data. Instead of 60 people, I should have asked 6,000 people. मैं अगर 6,000 लोगों से पूछता, then I would be in confidence that okay, the trend says that more people like red, more people like green, more people, whatever may be the answer, but still it would be less than 60,000, 6 lakhs, 60 lakh, 6 million, 6 billion, furthermore. So if I ask, let's say 6 billion people, which is like practically very difficult, but we are dealing with abstract use case, so let's speak on that front. Let's say I have asked 6 crore people and results are kind of same, then what is the difference between taking input of 60 people versus 6 crore people? What you think?
assuring the result.
So accuracy in the result increases. So the whole organizations, business organizations, started understanding one thing. The more data you have at the input side, the more accurate information you guys get. And what is the use of information? Why people convert their data into information to take business decisions? How many manufacturing units I need to fulfill the requirement of my customers? On what basis I'm going to deploy that? The only base factor is data nowadays. So market analysis, market research, how much cost should I put in digital marketing to acquire more customer? Or should I focus more on digital marketing to retain or to make current customers reorder so that my business will be more? So people realize that acquiring new customer is way more costly than retaining a customer. That's why people tend to give you offer like on first order, receive 100% cashback on your wallet so that you will order again. And their marketing cost will get saved and their sale figure will hike. Their sale figure will definitely improve. And that's the reason people have transformed their businesses digitally in many ways due to data. But wait, is it very easy that just have more data and you're done, your business will grow? Okay, I would say this is probably not a myth, this is true. But wait, how much more data you require? That's the question. So every organization started dealing with more presence, means like more data on internet, more campaigns on internet, more ways to have customer interactions, like they have apps, iOS app, Android app, web app, everything. And that actually started rising the data, which even organizations don't know what to do with that data. Number one. Number two, which is very important, whether you have capacity to store that data. Because if you see these figures, 1.94 petabyte per month, one petabyte is 1024 terabyte. Oh my God. And Google is more amazing. Like, you guys do 12 billion search queries on Google every day. 12 billion, I'm talking. 12 billion search queries. Only Google search engine. Forget about other services like YouTube. On YouTube, they have posted like 900 million hours of videos are being watched, unique viewers per month. Means if you watch a video twice, it won't count two times. It will count only once. That's the part of one survey. So, sorry. Where they are storing this data? How they are managing constantly increasing storage? Well, many people may answer cloud. But wait, cloud is also someone managing on your behalf, right? So, ek din aapki hard disk to full honi hai, uske baad kya? So, the day you guys started feeling pain to store or process the data, this data is called as big data. This data is called as big data. But wait, what is big data? Any data that is problematic for you to store and process. Now, it can be volume-wise problematic, it can be velocity-wise problematic, or it can be variety-wise problem. Problems are many, like store and processing. The data which is very difficult to store or process is big data. Very simple. Layman's term. Technically, it has many parameters, but I'm not interested in that right now. So, now the problem, instead of growing my business, I started getting a problem, big data. This was probably the biggest problem of the decade 2005 to 2015. Every organization got a big struggle to manage big data. Now there are tools like, there are many tools actually, but the very famous and free tool was Hadoop, which was whatever, it is a tool. But wait, then I have to hire a person. Then what is the problem with big data storage and processing? I am hiring a person who is capable of making that big data get stored in my organization, as well as it will be easy to process. So ultimately, the information which you are going to get, what you are going to do with this information, what is the final outcome through this information in any company, tell me.
Business revenue.
But how will you take, means how will you increase the business revenue through information?
Business strategies will be planned, and exactly, accordingly business decisions will be taken.
So this information will help you, means help the business owners or department owners, or let's say leaders, to take some decisions, whether those are strategic decisions or optimization decisions, whatever. So ideally, this data will help to take some decision which will help business. Now, not every organizational leader is technically what I can say aware, like he or she may not be an IT graduate or so. But then what should I do then? So represent this information in such a way that it will be easy for them to understand. So that format of representation is called as report. So there can be any sort of report. So I would say visualization. So that's why data visualization is very important nowadays. Even if you say, Atul, just take this data and find out the student with maximum marks. Atul will be like, oh my God, there are 50,000 students. It will be very difficult. Can you give me a bar chart or some sort of line chart where I can just easily put a point? Okay, this is the maximum mark. This is the minimum mark. It would be easy for me also, despite being a technical person. Right. So report is a graphical representation of your data, right? So three things right now, I am speaking about three things: analysis, big data, and reporting. So problem kya hai? Ye tino to bahut easy hai. Yes, these are easy, but these are independently three different departments of most of the organization. Big data is like big data engineer hire karo, Java developer hire karo, or some sort of technical person hire karo and get it done. Analytics may have different types of people, like technical, non-technical, domain experts, business analysts, many type of people are part of that particular thing. And now comes reporting. Here you need people who are really good in data visualization tools, like Microsoft Power BI, Tableau, or even Python and R nowadays have great capabilities to generate reports. But wait, I am talking about three different sets of people. No, nowadays IT industry is demanding all these skills for, wait, every business, not just IT industry, is demanding these all skills to be present in single person. And that's what data science, data scientist is. What is data science? Data science is a person who should be capable of doing everything with data. Right from data capturing to data processing, data cleaning, data analytics to data visualization. So there are three segments of data science. It's a science, actually. It's not just data mining. It's not just data visualization. It's not just processing. It is probably combination of all these things, but with the help of some tools. It's not like you have to do analytics means you have to use stats only. Yeah, statistics is highly essential skill. But wait, I am weak in mathematics. Who is asking you to learn mathematics from scratch? You should know what is the difference between linear regression and polynomial regression, where to apply which. That's the only thing you should know. That's all. Rest of the things are already written like libraries. So you just are responsible for it. See, basically you don't know about anything detailed about how your car engine or bike engine works. They have gears. What's the size of gear? What is first gear, second gear, fourth gear? Still you are able to drive bike or car. There are auto transmission cars also, in which you even don't get to work with directly gears. You don't give in commands to change the gears. Just like that, now data science industry has been mature enough to offer you most of the complicated things as libraries. You just have to utilize them. So see how machine learning has transformed the world. Till now,
every IT guy was doing this. What? Data logic output was information. Or I would say this is output. Input, logic, output. Now, what is machine learning? You don't provide logic. You provide input. You provide output also. And you provide some algorithm or some logic which will produce or which will find out pattern in that data, so that next time when that machine receives some input, it should predict the output. Wow. So if I design a machine learning algorithm in such a way that I feed the data of all like weather forecast related information in one computer. So in this month, what was the temperature? In this month, what was the temperature? Like that, in 2023, in March month, what would be the temperature of Pune, specifically this area? So my algorithm should be able to predict that. And that's what machine learning. Machine is capable of learning from data we provide. So the more data you provide to machine learning, the accuracy of prediction it would be going to make for sure. But wait, data has to be in particular format only. Data has to be in particular file only. Data has to has particular parameters only. What if I am receiving data from 3 or 4 different, what I can say, types? Then probably you need to pre-process the data and convert it into single format. Okay, interesting. So how can I do that? This process is very traditional, and earlier many people used to know it as data warehousing, but now you can use in any ETL tool to achieve that. But wait, every organization has cost factor also. Okay, so data engineer or data scientist should be responsible for capturing the data, like from SQL or any other data sources. He should be able to take the decision which data is useful, which data is useless. For analytics, obviously, ultimately karna to analytics hi hai. Chahe wo data scientist ho, machine learning, AI ho, kuch bhi ho. The final thing you guys need to do is analytics. But with data science, the expectations are accuracies in analytics. So I am a data analyst. So whether my analysis is wrong or right, it's okay, because I can blame the data. I'm a data scientist. You can't do that, because you're a data scientist. You should be in a position to tell that this data is not sufficient to take decisions. I need more data. And what you need more, you should be able to tell. And how can I tell? Obviously, based on algorithm, statistics algorithm, which you're going to use. So do I need to learn stats? At least functionally, yes. Practically, even if you are not master of stats, it's okay. So many people say that data science is the sugar-coated, or like it's a highly advanced version of mathematics and statistics. Somewhat, yes. But it's not plain stats or maths. Not at all. Absolutely no. You are not going to do any sum in this. It's a technology. It's a use of technology to apply stats to derive accurate predictions from data. As simple as this. So my definition of data science is do whatever you want. Derive correct predictions by using stats with the help of technology. That's it. Simplest possible term. Now, this is too much. Like, this is way beyond understanding. Like, then there are hell lot of algorithms in stats, hell lot of technologies in IT. So which technology, which algorithms? Now algorithms depend on data, but tools are limited. Trust me, tools are very few. So any visualization tool, any programming language, if you know, you can be a great data scientist. But if you just search the internet, if you just go through few of the websites, you will find Python everywhere. You will find R everywhere. You will find Tableau. These names will appear n number of times. So what's so special about these names?
This is the great question. Python is probably, as of today, easiest language to learn for people who don't know programming. I repeat, Python is the easiest language to get started with people who don't know programming, who are from non-IT background. But why should I learn programming? I'm from non-IT background. Because suppose if I want to build a data science stack, then as I told you, I need to take care of source, like which is my data source, what type of data I need. Then I need to clean the data. So I would say data pre-processing. Data pre-processing. Then I would need to apply some kind of ETL. I may use SQL like programming language. Then I will use some kind of reporting tool like Microsoft Power BI, then Tableau, or there are a hell lot of tools. And then I will get the final output in the form of report. But wait, for capturing data, there are different tools. For pre-processing data, there are different tools. There are Informatica, Ab Initio like ETL tools, SQL, you guys know. Reporting tool, I just pronounced. So these many things I need to buy or learn because many of them are not free. But what if I tell you all this is easily possible with only one thing, Python. With only one thing, Python. What about stats and maths? Just Python. They have libraries. They have interesting libraries for that. Even I would not underestimate R. But if you say that, are these the only two options available in IT? No, I have done this with Java since last 5 years. Yeah, I have used Python more, but for a few projects, we had restrictions to use Java. I have successfully used Java. But why Python is famous? I told you the reason. It's probably the easiest language right now on the earth to get started with. Does that mean Java is difficult? No, lengthy. The thing which you can do with Java in 5 lines, Python can probably do it in 2 lines. By the way, I am a Java developer. I call myself as a Java developer. If given a choice, I would choose Java over Python any day. But here, the fact is, as a business owner, I have to choose Python. All three names are free. Like Java, OpenJDK is free, Python is free, R is free. So if I decide to do sourcing of data, pre-processing, extract, transform, load, then analytics. So here I will write analytics. Analytics as well as reporting. I don't need to spend any money if I have Python resources available in my organization. Whole stack of data science can be easily implemented and executed by using Python or even R. But Python is more versatile than R because Python can be used in software development also, data science, machine learning, AI, robotics, IoT, everything. So do I need to see every company loves different set of tools, but I'm focusing one point that if you start learning things like how to process the data, like what should be the entry point to do that? See, if you want to go into analytics, the bare minimum thing you can do is get the data in normal spreadsheet and try to analyze that. So people who have worked with Excel sheets also, they also know analytics. People who have done SQL queries, they are also kind of doing data analytics. I would say data analytics is much more. So where should I start? See, SQL is a very powerful language. It's a very amazing language. But now many people are using different types of databases. MongoDB, Amazon, DynamoDB, or Redis, NoSQL databases. So one set of data is coming from SQL-like database. One set of data is coming from NoSQL-like database. So they have different data is same. But format is different, then it becomes difficult to analyze this data. Now, somewhere you are going to face the challenge of big data also. So all these problems can be easily solved by newer libraries, new technologies like Python's, Pandas, NumPy, Matplotlib. These are capable of probably doing all these things. ये जो सारी चीजें मैंने यहाँ पे लिख रखी है, सोर्सिंग, डेटा प्री प्रोसेसिंग, ETL और डेटा एनालिटिक्स एंड रिपोर्टिंग, एवरीथिंग कैन बी इजीली डन विथ सम लाइब्रेरी ऑफ पाइथन, आर और जावा. सो डू आई नीड टू नो पाइथन फ्रॉम स्क्रैच? पाइथन इज वेरी इजी, आर इज वेरी इजी, जावा इज इक्वली इजी. इनफैक्ट इफ यू सी द इंडस्ट्री, देर आर मोर companies who are using Java than Python overall. I'm not talking about data science overall, but when it comes to data science, Python is number one for sure. But data visualization, like business analysts, generally those people are domain experts. Like in one of my company where I was working, I had finance domain experts. They're not technical people, but then to visualize the data, they tend to use tools like BIRT, business intelligence and reporting, or nowadays these guys are using Tableau, which is amazing. Tableau claims that you can, if you have good data, you can generate any report in 10 seconds, only 10 seconds. So, but it comes with a cost, $72 per month. So almost it goes to $1,000 inclusive of taxes for one user. So it's so expensive. And I have done all the reportings which I used to do using Tableau by using a free and open source library of Python called as Matplotlib. So I saved around $1,000 per year for my company. One license cost I'm talking about. So just imagine if one company decides to shift from reporting tool to code-based report generation, how much cost they are saving. So it's not about cost. Data science is more about accuracy in predictions, accuracy in analytics. So the more data you have, you are going to face a problem called as big data somewhere in your life. So that problem can easily be solved by tools like Hadoop, and Python can easily integrate with Hadoop. Python can easily read the big data, I would say. So, to analyze the big data, you need something which is capable, or I would say versatile enough to deal with any integration of such tools. So you can easily do that, isn't it? So to be a data scientist, I would say you can start with SQL or Python and grab analytics. See, you have to grow your analytical skills. That's all. That's the first thing. Second thing, you should be capable of generate some kind of report. And once you start mastering in one tool, you can master any other tool. It's just matter of few things. Like once you learn Python programming language, you guys can learn Java also. You guys can learn R also. Any language you can learn. And about careers. See, if you get a tag of data scientist, I can probably include you in business analyst team. I can probably include you in visualization team. I can probably involve you in data pre-processing ETL activities. So there are a hell lot of opportunities available for you. But for that, you need to understand the business core proposition offered by business. So you need to have some kind of experience where you guys will be able to utilize the data. So, Mr. Ankit is here for you guys. So, rest of the session, he will be driving. So, in the end, you guys can have questions. And about a few questions, where can we do Python course? Yeah, Rupali ma'am will guide you for that in the end. So, over to you, Aniket. Thank you, guys. Rupali ma'am, are you able to hear me?
Yes, Atul sir. Hello everyone. Ankit sir is here. So now I would request Ankit sir to please take over the session. Ankit sir.
Thank you, guys. Rupali ma'am, just switch the host because I need to just drop.
Yes, sure. Yeah. I'll do that. Ankit sir, am I audible to you?
Yeah, you are.
Yes, yes. All right.
Do I have screen sharing? Yeah.
Yes.
I do. So is my screen visible?
Yes. Yes,
it is. Could you just do a quick mic check?
Yes.
You're audible.
Perfect.
Yes.
Thank you. Sorry for the interruption there. So as I was saying, I hope you all are keeping safe.
Yes.
And I cannot emphasize enough on, how this topic is so relevant to the condition in which we are. I'm sure a lot of you have heard about, the scans of lungs being analyzed, their scans being analyzed to make sure that there are no patches, instead of actually doing X-rays, data being used on the lung photographs to basically understand whether COVID has happened or not. I think, that kind of sets the context of the importance of data and how we are using data in the current world. And, I love this saying by Geoffrey Moore, and he's a very famous author as well. He says that, without big data analytics, companies are blind and deaf, okay? And they're wandering out onto the web, where most of the customers are these days, like a deer on a freeway. It can get hit any time and die, right? So, and you will see that a lot of organizations have either reinvented themselves or have gone down the drain. There are organizations who we always think about, why a Nokia being a market leader in the mobile space, mobile handset space, suddenly, got wiped out in a matter of just 10 years. And why was Apple, which was into computers, suddenly took over the complete handset market and has never looked back? It's all because of data. They understand what their consumers want and they're acting upon it. Ability to have, data about your consumers, consumer preferences, or data regarding your operations, how to optimize them. This is what data is all about. And I think Atul was explaining about how do you use various tools. So I'm not going to delve too much into the kind of tools that are available as of today. I mean, you have all sets of tools ranging from R to, utilizing Python for doing machine learning. There is a host of things that you can do, and I'll touch onto it very, very briefly, but not go into too much detail on that. But what I want to really impress upon you is basically the future of data science. So these are snapshots that I've pulled out of the $1 trillion economy report that is going to be, that is basically a roadmap for making India a $1 trillion economy by 2025. Okay, so this is the 5-year roadmap. And suffice it to say that in the next 5 years, there are about 5 lakh data scientist jobs. I'm not talking about any other jobs. I'm talking about specifically data scientist jobs that are there in the next 5 years. It's second only to cybersecurity in India in terms of a job profile. So having said that, if we are talking about, what is going to be the data science and data science linked revenue for various sectors. So while consumer goods and retail, you're already looking at a lot of organizations who have become unicorns because they have understanding of the data of their consumers, right? So all consumer goods companies, which just imagine a Procter & Gamble or a HUL not knowing which are the markets which it is strong in. And if it doesn't know, if it is not able to predict what will be the demand in the next season or in the next month or in the next week in a particular geography, right? data science at the end of the day is different from data analytics, right? So data science is data analytics plus prediction, right? Ability to predict through modeling, that is the key for any business these days, right? You might have heard about, and you know Amazon, right? All of you must have at some point or the other purchased something from Amazon. Amazon's logistics capability, ability to deliver products to you just in time or in the shortest time possible, is coming from its ability to predict what are you going to want before you want, before you search for it on Amazon. So it brings it to your nearest warehouse. Now, that is the kind of prediction capability which is making them really lean as businesses and relevant to the consumers as businesses. So if you see, consumer goods and retail is going to contribute about almost 20% of the total market from a revenue standpoint based on data science. Agriculture is going to be the next big thing. So even today, as we speak, there are a lot of companies like Monsanto who are doing contract farming in India, but they have no clue when they're doing contract farming till the very end, whether the crops, the committed crop volume is going to come to them or not, right? So they have to send their executives all the way and then they try and collect that data. Now, you know, we are flying drones. In fact, I represent Foxberry, I head the company, and we fly drones and check the crop length just through a drone. We're able to do analytics on top of it. And we are able to tell them that, you know, basis this, we are able to predict that when is the crop going to be mature or how much volume of the crop is going to mature. So the kind of processes that are existing in the marketing market today from agriculture standpoint are phenomenal. Banking and insurance. I want all of you to go and look at something called as Oken. You might know Kuntal Shah from CRED, right? So CRED is a platform for basically taking a short-term loan. What Oken is doing is basically collecting your behavior of spending across all platforms, including point of sale machines, and linking it to your profile, right? So on one hand, we are collecting through your CIBIL score, what is the loan that you are eligible for. And on the other hand, we are completely mapping the spending pattern, which will ensure that we know that even if your income is this much, you will eventually be able to save only this much. So as a bank, I want to know whether you'll be able to return my loan or not. It is not just dependent on your income. It is dependent on your saving. For understanding saving, you need to know both the income as well as the cost. Telecom, media, and IT is big time into this. In fact, right now, the biggest job market in data science is in banking and insurance industry, by the way. We are right now building an insurance product, and we'll also be offering internships through this program for doing predictive analysis on insurance data to basically anticipate needs of insurance basis demographic data of people. So that is something which will be that's a pretty cool thing that we're working on. And telecom, media, and IT has been using data science for quite some time. I mean, they are the bellwethers in this. Energy is big, because the kind of energy consumption patterns which are being tracked with the sensors now on automated meters, it's phenomenal the kind of work that they are doing. Just imagine that you cannot store electricity anywhere. The electricity that is generated has to be let out. So it's essentially wastage, sheer wastage of electricity if we overproduce electricity, right? So imagine how good a work can data science do if it is able to predict, you know, exactly how much electricity is going to be needed every second, right? So you can plan the infrastructure accordingly. In a resource hungry country like India, it's a boon, right? Transport and logistics, I already explained about what Amazon is doing, and it's a world-class solution, best in class. Auto manufacturing and assembly, you must have all heard about Industry 4.0, where complete automation through sensor network is happening, which will allow us to generate a lot of data across the complete assembly line and make sure that, you know, the optimizations with respect to material handling, pilferage, everything is reduced, you know, and it doesn't require any kind of forecasting manually, but it should be able to look at complete integration of your raw material and being able to tell even your OEMs, you know, what is going to be your requirement when, right? So that they also can be just in time, because the biggest cost in manufacturing and assembly is the cost of inventory, right? The capital cost of having inventory. If you can reduce that, you're a viable business. Otherwise, you're not, right? So especially if you look at the likes of, say, Maruti Suzuki and its OEM, say, Gabriel. Gabriel has to be just in time to give the right price to Maruti. So Maruti has to help them understand from the consumer standpoint, what is going to be the demand next month? And accordingly, what is the inventory that Gabriel should keep, which will then make sure that, you know, the whole supply chain is lean, which will ensure the best price to the consumer. Otherwise, it's everybody's loss, right? Public sector and healthcare, I mean, both are quite interlinked, and healthcare and public sector is right now booming with respect to data science. I know a few companies based out of Mumbai who are working on around 100 variables which can affect COVID spread in particular geographies. And this is something which is very, very interesting. I can't reveal more because they're trying to apply for a patent on the whole algorithm. But suffice it to say that a lot of people are using domain knowledge in healthcare to basically use data and thereby be able to predict basis your lifestyle, basis your food habits, basis your exercising, you know, what are the kind of diseases that you are more prone to. And there are a lot of platforms who are very, very keen on something like this, right? Having said that, you know, I've also basically given to you a basic breakup of what are the functions across these industries which are going to be contributing the most. Corporate business functions are going to be utilizing a lot of data. So you need to understand that data science has made its inroads right up to the top management. The value of data and its analysis and ability to predict is something which is a go-to for every CEO, every chief operating officer, every chief strategy officer, every chief information officer. If you are a chief, you need data. Otherwise, you know, you are playing a blind, right? Hardly you will win, right? Marketing and sales is using it for consumer acquisition, for making sure that there is high volume, higher revenue per user and whatnot. Operations is to make sure that the cost is cut and we have more lean and lesser costs. Risk, big time. I'm sure you might have heard or maybe you might have experienced, if from your credit card, there is a transaction that happens, which is not, you know, fitting into your profile of expenditure, you will immediately get a call from your bank. Right? I'm sure a lot of you must have experienced this or at least heard about it from your friends. So if there is a, you know, OTP is quite famous in India, but in US or Europe or for that matter, the Middle East or Israel, you know, you don't have OTPs. So if somebody has your credit card number and your 3-digit PIN, then transaction can happen directly. They don't require anything. And when such transactions happen, you will immediately get a call from your bank. And that is basically understanding your behavior of expenditure that the bank has. And if it doesn't fit into your model of expenditure, then they will immediately call you and check whether this transaction has been done by you or not. Right. So making sure that fraud detection happens is data science has a very, very big role to play. And of course, strategy and corporate finance is definitely a very, very big plus. You know, I've talked a lot about, you know, how each of these industries, I want to pick up a few in e-commerce, you know, identifying your consumers, understanding their behavior, being able to recommend products basis their behavior and looking at feedback from them. These are three of the most critical things in e-commerce, which make, if a unicorn is not, if a company is not looking at these three, of course there are more, but if they are not looking at these three, then they can't be a unicorn ever. From a manufacturing perspective, you know, ability to predict problems, because if your supply chain is disrupted, it's immediate loss to the organization. Monitoring systems to maintain the health of the complete assembly line and the value chain. Automating manufacturing units, thereby reducing chances of errors. Maintenance scheduling, very, very big item. Any outage is immediate revenue loss, not just profit. It's revenue loss. It's unacceptable, because your fixed costs are so high that if you do not produce for even half a day, it's a huge loss, right? So maintenance scheduling is very, very important. And anomaly detection is, again, one big area. India is very, very strongly looking at semiconductor fabrication. And, it's very important to understand that with such high precision industries coming in India, manufacturing will be completely dependent on data, completely, right? So any anomaly has to be looked into, investigated, and made sure that it doesn't happen again. From a banking perspective, fraud detection, I already talked about. Credit risk modeling, I talked about OKN, and I talked about what Kunal Shah is doing. Customer lifetime value. Now, this is another very, very important matrix. And it's not just being used by banking, but it's also being used by e-commerce to basically understand whether, if you're acquiring a customer, what is the lifetime value of that customer? You are able to predict that this is, what that person has been buying till now, and, how that pattern is changing and how that life stage is. If you are a 16-year-old guy or a 20-year-old guy, from there to when you are 30 years old, when you are 40 years old, when you are 50 years old, what are you going to buy from the platform, and what will be the approximate value of that lifetime customer, right? So those are things which are very, very important to understand. And basis this, unicorns are getting their valuations. So, I really want to impress upon that it is it's completely dependent on the lifetime value multiplied by the number of customers that you have. Medical image analysis, I already talked about, how lung images are being used to do analysis, whether COVID is there or not. Drug discovery, definitely. Bioinformatics, virtual assistants to now this is very, 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 very key to data science and being able to predict stuff. Virtual assistants is something which is very, very up and coming for data science guys. You might have heard of chatbots. You might have heard of natural language processing and artificial intelligence in chatbots. In fact, we are right now working with a transport government organization in Dubai, who wants to, create avatars, three-dimensional avatars, who basically from a camera, when there is a kiosk, you will be able to look at the person. Through facial recognition, you will be able to also identify the ethnicity and the country from which the person is. And accordingly, the three-dimensional avatar is going to talk to that person in that language and make sure that there are cultural issues, challenges, which are taken care of, right? So it's very, very important to understand where this whole field is going. This is really cutting edge work. Even the avatar would wear clothes which are more, key to that ethnicity. Uber has been talking about self-driving cars for quite some time now. I don't remember. I don't know whether you know or not, but there was a 1st April prank that was done by Ola, that they have already come out with self-driving aeroplanes. So, while they're joking about it, but Ola is seriously working on it. Uber is seriously working on it. And China, Didi is seriously working on it, right? So self-driving cars is tremendous amount of data, making sure that, you do not have an accident, right? So tremendous amount of data and tremendous amount of processing. Car monitoring systems, you already see that in the high-end cars in India now. There is complete car monitoring system in a BMW or a Mercedes, which is already in place. But of course, there are improvements happening, enhancing the safety of passengers, being able to predict. You might have come across some of the cars where there is a camera in the dashboards. Okay, Mercedes also has it, BMW also has it, Audi also has it. there's a car in the there's a camera in the dashboard which is monitoring your eyes, okay, and your driving pattern. Okay, the moment your driving pattern is such that you are driving too fast or too slow, or you're drooping sometimes, and you're suddenly shaking the steering starts shaking. Okay, it will wake you up. And if you continue to do it, it will shut down the engine completely. It will announce and it will shut down the engine. Now, imagine you're saving lives, right? With data. So I think there's some really cool stuff that's happening in transport sector. And, customer segmentation, strategic decision marketing, algorithm trading is big right now. I mean, you might have all heard about this movie called The Big Short, right? It was about 2008 complete meltdown of the real estate market in subprime mortgage crisis in the US, and how one organization made about $42 billion by betting against it. Right. So purely data. I mean, that's what you can make money out of if you know what needs to be done. So as I said, there are quite a few use cases of these unicorns. I won't go too much deep into it, but social analytics by Facebook to Facebook's revenue model is advertisement. So ability to custom to do segmentation of the customer, and then do cluster analysis and basis that deploy ads which are relevant to you, and giving that as a platform to the advertiser. It's not just first, but it's also the best in class. So, you know, this is something which is a very, very interesting space. If you are somebody who is interested in consumer behavior, you know, social analytics is the place to be from a data science perspective. As I said, Amazon is continuously tracking not just across the application, but also wherever you are using Alexa, it is noting down your complete profile, what you are watching, what you are doing. In fact, you'll be surprised, actually. I don't know how many of you are aware of this, but Amazon has why would they have an Amazon Prime? Why movies, right? Two reasons. One is AWS, which is their web hosting service, that gets utilized. That's number one. Number two, how do you go into the next phase of selling, right? Experiential selling. Where does fashion come from, right? Movies, serials, TV soaps, right? You see somebody wearing a nice jacket. You see someone wearing a nice shirt. You know, and then you want to buy it, right? That particular style. Amazon will be very soon launching. In fact, image-based, they have already launched. But in video, you will have that option of looking at that shirt or that trouser and buying it from Amazon then and there. Add it to your cart while you are watching the movie. That's data for you, ladies and gentlemen, and how you do sales, this is data, right? Uber is already working on optimizing rides, and surge pricing that Uber came with is the reason why they are a unicorn, right? Being able to charge more revenue when the supply is low is an industry benchmark as far as transportation is concerned, right? I mean, I can talk about others as well, but I think you basically get the idea of how important it is for you to become big as an organization. If you without data, it is not possible. And so I'm not going to talk into too much detail about the skill map, because I think Atul has covered a lot of it from a technical standpoint, but suffice it to say that there are basically three pillars of data science. First is, your understanding of the domain in which you want to do data analysis and apply principles of data science. For example, if it is healthcare, then you need to know healthcare. You need to know what the data is. What is the importance of that data? If you don't know it, then there is a problem, right? So you need to understand a little bit about the domain. You need to have a basic understanding of mathematics, and you need to have a certain statistical aptitude, because if you don't understand basic economics, you don't understand basic econometric modeling, then there is a challenge you're going to face from a business application standpoint. And third is basically computer science, right? So you need to understand to some extent, you know, how, what is the data? What is the metadata? How do you govern this data? How do you pre-process the data? How do you validate it? What is the data infrastructure? Where is it stored? How is it retrieved? You know, you need to understand a little bit of that. And therefore, database languages is something that you should know a little bit. And that, that basically comprises of the data science. And, you know, in the next 5 years, I think from the standpoint of where the jobs lie, while professional services is the highest, I personally, I would bet on finance and insurance as the next big thing in data science, because while you can use data for analyzing anything, but it has to have a purpose, right? And right now, fintech is the most bet upon sector when it comes to database decision making, and there's a lot of value to be unlocked in this sector. Of course, manufacturing, information, healthcare, retail are all there, but I think e-commerce and finance and insurance and their cross application of use cases is going to be the most important thing. So you know, I didn't want to go into too much of detailing, but you know, this is fundamentally you know, how the industry looks like. And you know, as I was saying, there are about 5 lakh jobs in the next 5 years, second only to cybersecurity, that you know, data science and related fields are going to have. You know, I think that should be pretty much it. I'm open to any questions that you guys have. Just open up the
yeah, so I request all the participants, if you have any queries, you may please ask Ankit sir.
Hello sir, good evening. Sir, right from 12th class, like before we get into, so we aim to do the computer science as a engineering stream. But parallelly, what can we do to get into the data science and the kind of right now the job opportunities you talked about?
Okay. Two very, very important things that you need to do. Number one is, from a computer science perspective, one is you are you need to understand Python for sure. Okay, that's very, very important, because whatever data you are crunching, until and unless you can automate it, there is very limited application of it. Okay, so that's number one, right? Second is, you need to get certain domain knowledge. Knowledge of computer science alone or handling data alone won't help. If you want to get into data science, you need to pick which domain you want to get into, or get exposure to two to three domains. That is where you will then be able to get into predictive modeling. Otherwise, you can do only analytics. I mean, you can do past, but you won't be able to do any you know, predictions. You need to understand the domain to be able to do predictions. Does that answer your question?
Yes, sir. Thank you very much.
Yeah. Hi, Ankit. Good evening. This is Anant.
Yeah, Anant. Tell me.
Actually, I own a company, and I've been into IT for almost 25 years. Actually, I have attended this session for my son. But there is one thing is for sure, that too much data collection is going to hamper your privacy. Because it's going to be a tough time for individual if we peep into too much data of a person. It's going to hamper the privacy. That is one thing. And second is, I've been into telecom for quite some years. Mm-hmm. And again, I did this data science in 2006. And to all listeners, I can assure that yes, if they have domain knowledge, they can probably do a better job in this domain or any domain where they have some experience, and they will have to read the data. Means there is a say that read between the lines. So every time you need to correlate the data along with the results. And then only these youngsters, they can map the data and they can definitely see a good future in this domain. Thanks for your session. It was a wonderful session, Ankit.
Thank you so much. But in order to address your point regarding data privacy, you know, if you guys are interested in data science, and you seem to be because you're in this webinar, please read the data privacy bill that was tabled in India in the parliament in 2019. Okay, you will understand the way GDPR has come in Europe. There is a similar data privacy and protection bill coming in India, which will limit the kind of data that you are able to get without consent. Okay, consent-based data collection will still happen. Third-party data is already going out. You might have heard that Chrome is going to shut down usage of cookies very soon. It's already you know, in the works. Firefox had already done it. Safari had already done it. So essentially,
it is not about that data's privacy. It's about the information of the person, what he's doing, what he's planning to do. That kind of privacy is going to hamper because of this data collection. Means sure, if you collect too much data about a person, so but you'll be, it is very much predictable that, okay, tomorrow Anand Doshi is going to Mumbai, so he's going to stay in this hotel, he's going to eat this food, or he's going to travel to Indore soon. So what he is going to do, that privacy is going to hamper because of this huge collection of data.
You are absolutely right. You're absolutely right. And it's an ethical dilemma. You know, where do you draw the line? You're absolutely right. I see some other questions as well. Atharv Fade, he's asked how data science can help a digital marketer. I mean, as a digital marketer, the first and foremost thing that you require to be able to do targeted advertising is understanding the metadata about your consumer, right? So ability to understand, you know, how, as I was saying, ability to understand what your consumer is currently doing on the platform. And therefore, if you're talking about, say, engaging him more, right? If you're a social media organization, right? Let's say if you're Facebook, right? You would know that 80% of the people who like travel-related pages, they also like, say, for example, food-related pages, right? I'm just giving an example, right? So as a digital marketer, if you know these two things, right, that's the way you engage them, if engagement is your objective. But if you are looking at transaction, so something like you might know that if you go and visit something in Amazon in the browser, it will store it in your cookie, and when you see a Facebook ad, it is customized to what you searched in the in Amazon. So basically, it's reading your mind, storing it into a cookie, and then again and again showing you the same product so that the chances of you buying it increases. So as a digital marketer, it helps you to understand the consumer psyche and therefore move closer towards your objective, whether it is engagement, whether it is transaction, whether it is whatever. Does that answer your question, Atharv? I guess it does. Palash, I think, has asked a question about finance and banking sector. You know, we can talk about various sectors. If you want, I can take up one example. I already shared about fraud detection, but let's say you want to basically understand if somebody is buying insurance. So let's say you are 45 years old, right? And you are buying insurance, life insurance, right? But, you know, your need for health insurance and what category of health insurance you should go for is coming from actuarial sciences and your ability to predict how many of these 45-year-olds living in these particular cities, how many kids do they have, would they have a HUF file or not, would they be willing to invest in a product which is both insurance plus SIP or only insurance or health insurance. Or so these are maps that you create of probability that if a person is doing X, then what is the probability of him doing Y, Z, A, B, C? Okay. And accordingly, you target the consumer. So in banking, what a relationship manager is doing right now, or a wealth manager is doing right now by talking to the clients, this is something which is being done en masse for people who are digitally interacting with the banks. Okay. Does that answer your question, Palash?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir. I got my answer. Thank you, sir.
Looking at other questions.
Hi, Ankit. This is Ashish here.
Yeah.
So my question is to the change the career path related. So now I am doing the .NET stuff. So I just want to switch my profile. I just want to switch my technology. So for your point of view, which is the best? Could you please suggest me one of the best? What will you suggest? Means from so database actually, point of view as well. As the first question, you suggest that there is a Python as well. But from database point of view, what is the best?
Actually, you'll have to do both. Structured. See, data as a data scientist, you will have to deal with both structured and unstructured data. Okay. You will have to deal with a sequential database and non-sequential databases as well. You can't choose that, you know, I will work only with Mongo, or I will only work with Postgres, or I'll only work with SQL, or I'll only work with MySQL, right? So you can't do that. Mm-hmm. You need to see basics of all databases remain the same. You need to understand at least one of relational and one of non-relational databases. Okay. So that's something which you should definitely know. Since you're working with .NET, I'm assuming you would have worked with SQL also.
Yeah.
Yeah. So go for one non-relational database as well. Mongo is a good thing to go for. You can learn that probably within a month. So Mongo is definitely going to help. Python, I'm saying more because from a statistical standpoint and machine learning standpoint, Python is the most accepted language, especially from data science perspective. But Ashish, my sincere suggestion, and I can't counsel you on what's best for you, but you know, my sincere suggestion would be, since you are working for .NET, please understand the industries for which you were building the applications. I'm assuming you are coming from a service industry.
Yeah.
Right? Your clients, what industries they were working for, knowingly, unknowingly, you understand a lot about that industry now.
Okay.
So think very carefully if you want to switch industry or you want to remain with the same industry to get domain knowledge. You need domain knowledge. Not just computer.
Oh.
Right? If you use the same industry from which your clients were coming, then you have a head start. Otherwise, you'll have to go in as somebody who is looking at the data and, you know, from the database and then building frameworks on top of it. But you will have to learn domain if you switch your current domain. I mean, for example, if you are looking at let's say your client was Smith & Wesson, right? It's a gun manufacturer, right? So then you could probably look at, okay, from a e-commerce perspective, you know, what can I do, right? What kind of predictive analytics I can do in consumer behavior on e-commerce platforms. So this is the way you need to think. I don't know your industry, and I think we'll have to have a more detailed discussion to understand what exactly, you're aware of and what this thing. But I also see Nishiganda asking me, I'm currently doing actuarial sciences. Wow. What would be more beneficial for my career, PG data science or masters in stats? So, Nishiganda, are you there? Okay. So, see, PG in data science is all about application. Okay. Masters in statistics, at least in India, is not an applied field. Okay. It's more of theory. Right. So please be very conscious about whether you want to be into research or whether you want to be into application. If you are going to be into application, then, you know, PG in data science makes sense. It's about what gives you that kick.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Yogesh, sorry, can you repeat your question? I see it now. I'm not from IT background. Will it affect my data science journey? I know C and C++ though. I'm MBA in marketing and analytics. I'm really interested in automobile sector. Will my degree influence the same? Okay. Durgesh, okay, there are two, three things here. You're not from IT background. So you will need to understand a little bit of basics of how do you handle data? How do you collect data? How do you process that data? So you will need to understand a little bit about computers for sure. When you're saying C and C++, I understand that you understand object-oriented programming. So you won't face a lot of challenge. It is going to be a quick, learning for you. Sorry, I'm in your cabin. Sorry, guys. So as I was saying that it will definitely be necessary. But since you have done C++, you understand, oops, it should not be a problem. When you are saying that you are MBA in marketing and analytics and you being interested in automobile sector, okay? So while you understand analytics, so I'm assuming that when I showed this, okay, you have mathematical and statistical aptitude. I'm assuming that since you are an MBA in analytics, you would know a little bit about that. You must have done your SPSS, you must have done your R, you must have done your maybe Anovate also, right? So you understand a little bit of this. The third piece is what is missing, Durgesh, which is the understanding of the domain. So that's where you have to be. You have to gain some experience. Since you want to do it in automobile sector, then my suggestion would be you should look at, how do you gain experience in that sector? Because just wanting to do it versus, you know, get a job there, sweat it out for a few years, you will understand a lot. And that is when your career takes off. Okay. Tejas has asked me a very interesting question about how freshers can work as a data scientist. It's the same as working as a fresher into software development or any other field for that matter. You have to sweat it out. You have to do the groundwork to get your mind frame in the right space. So when you are getting into, you will not be a data scientist from day zero. It is not possible. Okay. You have to be a data analyst in the beginning. You have to perform the role of a data analyst. You have to perform the role of a data engineer. Okay. And then since you are in that organization for a few years, 2 years, 3 years, if you are very strong, very intellectual, very intelligent, you grasp very quickly, maybe even 6 months, that is when you can look at combining all three to be able to drive predictable business results. You always have to start with past. Okay. That is how you predict the future. There is no Pandit Rata na. I mean, he also asks you 10 questions about what is your father's name? What is your mother's name? It's all past, right? And basis that he predicts the future. I'm not saying that they're accurate, but you get the analogy, right? Madhuri Shinde, that also kind of answers your question, right? Harshvardhan Deshpande is basically asking me where can we get Python course. I think Rupali, you will have to take that separately. you can guide.
Yes, yes, I've messaged him, so I'll get back to him on this after the session.
Sorry, guys, have I missed any question? I'm sorry, there are so many questions out here. I'm not able to keep track. Is there somebody who I've missed out? I guess not. Parnal, I think that is something that Rupali will take care of. Where do you? By the way, from a BI tool perspective, while you're looking at Power, but also understand a little bit of Tableau. Okay, while Tableau is more expensive, but please understand that as a visualizer of data, you know, Power BI does, because it is so graphical user interface based, that you don't actually understand the underlying operations. Okay, it's very important to understand underlying operations of what data work is happening below when you are basically dragging and dropping certain things in Tableau or Power BI for that matter. It's important to get your fundamentals right when it comes to data analysis. So don't just depend on a graphical user interface based thing. Ki haan acha mere ko ne drag drop kiya result aa gaya. But you need to understand the underlying operation below. That's how you will become strong as a data scientist, because most of these tools will fail when you work with big data. There you will have to build your own models. And, you know, if you don't understand the basics now, later on in your career, it's going to be really difficult. Okay, I guess this is it. Thank you guys for listening. I think if there are any, there are no further questions, Rupali, you can take over.
Yes, yes. Thank you very much, Mr. Ankit Bhargava. And I would also thank Mr. Atur. Actually, he's not keeping well. He has tested positive for COVID, but still he was very keen on, giving this session. So I thank him. He has left the session. He is not able to speak. So yeah, I hope the session has given all the participants a much better insight of data science. And this webinar was conducted by APG Learning. I would just request all the participants that just in case, if you have any other query, you can just drop in a mail at contact@apglearning.in. All right. I repeat, contact@apglearning.in. Just in case if you have any other query, and do feel to reach us for more information for our products and programs. And thank you all the participants for being here. Once again, I thank Mr. Ankit Bhargava. Thank you.
Thanks, Ankit.
Thanks,
APG.
Thanks, Ankit.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. Have a good day and please be safe. Bye.
Yeah, thank you. You too. Bye.